Father, we choose to remember all your benefits, and we give you praise, we give you worship, we appreciate you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Beautiful King, excellent God, we bow before your throne. Glorious God, glorious God, beautiful King, excellent God, we bow before your throne. Beautiful God, glorious God, beautiful King, excellent God, we bow before you. Glorious God, beautiful King, excellent God, we bow before your throne, bow before your throne, worship out of me, before your throne, bow before your throne, bow before your throne. Worship out of me, and before your throne, Lord, the God of all, glorious God, glorious God, we bow before glorious God, beautiful King, excellent God, we bow before your throne, bow before your throne. Worship out of me, before your throne, Lord, glorious God, before your throne, worship at your feet, before your throne.
Almighty God, Almighty
Jehovah, Jehovah, the glory of God, we bow before you. Your name is Jehovah, Omega, Omega,
Thank you so much. Praise the Lord. Amen. You're welcome to Healing School for today. Amen. Could we welcome our internet audience for today's Healing School broadcast? Hallelujah. You're welcome today. Amen. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Glory, 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 glory. Praise the Lord. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I want to appreciate the leadership of Rema Nigeria for this great privilege to bring God's word here today. And specifically, I want to thank Reverend Shon Father Hansi for the privilege to share God's word in this meeting. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So we'll be looking at certain things that have to do with divine healing. Amen. Amen. The purpose for healing school is actually threefold. The first is that we put out God's word for healing. We put out God's word for healing. And then the second is that we minister to the sick as we are led by the Spirit of God. And then the third is that we train divine healing technicians. Glory to God. Who are divine healing technicians? Divine healing technicians are believers in Christ who know how to get the sick healed. And they just don't know how to get the sick healed. They actually get the sick healed. Praise the Lord. And then Daily Healing School is designed specifically for those with terminal cases. Amen. Those with terminal cases. Those whom doctors, medical science have given up on. Yes. You know, medical science, some diseases medical science calls incurable. They may be incurable to medical science, but to our Father God, there is no disease that is incurable. Actually, he laid that sickness, that disease on Jesus. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. So we're looking at the subject today. Seven reasons why we should know that healing is God's will for us. Seven reasons why we should know that healing is God's will for us. Seven reasons why we should know that healing is God's will for us. But we just start with the very first one. Amen. Reasons why we should know that healing is God's will for us. Amen. Healing is always God's will for us. Could we have our opening texts? Galatians, the third chapter. Galatians, the third chapter. Read from verse 13. Amen. Galatians chapter 3 from verse 13. Yes. Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Verse 29. And if ye be Christ's, then are ye Abraham's seed, and heirs according to the promise. Could we read it again from verse 13? Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Verse 29, and if ye be Christ's, then are ye Abraham's seed, and heirs according to the promise. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Then we'll go to Isaiah. Isaiah 53. Verses 4 and 5. Isaiah 53, verses 4 and 5. Isaiah 53, verse 4 and 5. Verse 4, surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Praise the Lord. Yeah, then Matthew chapter 8, verse 17. Glory to God. Matthew chapter 8, verse 17. That it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Esaias the prophet, saying, himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. That it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Esaias the prophet, saying, himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. Hallelujah. Then 1 Peter 2:24. 24. Amen. Hallelujah. 1 Peter 2:24. Are we there? Okay. 1 Peter. Just a moment, I'll be there. Good. 1 Peter 2:24. Thank you. Yeah.
You know, we can, some of us can quote some of these scriptures, but it's good we just look at it again and again and again. Verse 24, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. One more time, please. Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. Hallelujah. Yes, let's have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for your goodness to us. Thank you for your faithfulness, your loving kindness, your tender mercies. Thank you for your great love that you've lavished on us. Thank you. Thank you for your mercies. Thank you. Thank you for your great plan of redemption, which you planned, sent the Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, to consummate. Thank you for your word, which gives us a revelation of that plan. Dear Heavenly Father, we trust that by your Spirit you will unveil, unfold, and open up your word to our spirits, and that we will not only be hearers of your word, but doers of the same. And we give you all the praise and all the glory in advance for all that will be done in this meeting, in Jesus' name. And the people said, amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, looking at seven things, we'll just start from the very first, which is healing is always God's will for the sick because it is in his redemptive plan. Healing is always God's will for the sick because it is in his redemptive plan. Yes, it is in his redemptive plan. Before the fall of Adam and before the fall of man in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve, there was no record of sickness or disease in the Garden of Eden. Never any record of such. Sickness and disease came as a result of the fall of man. Amen. And, you know, the devil was just involved. He is the author of sickness and disease right from the very beginning. And so God began to deal with that problem. What happened when Adam and Eve sinned? The devil imparted into man's spirit spiritual death, which is the nature of Satan. And spiritual death gave birth to sickness and disease. Like someone said, sickness and disease is the foul offspring of its father Satan and its mother sin. If man didn't sin, there would never have been sickness or disease on the earth. But you know, God had a plan of redemption, which he planned. You know, Jesus is referred to as the lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world. And God began to execute his plan of redemption to redeem man from the devil's dominion. And so he began to say to Satan, I mean, yes, you shall bruise the heel of the seed of the woman, and he shall strike thy head. Yes, he shall bruise thy head. And so that's what Jesus actually eventually came to do. God was looking for how to bring his seed, that the seed of the woman, into the earth, and eventually did so through the loins of Abraham. Yes, he found a virgin conceived without the natural coming together of a man and a woman. Eventually, Jesus was born. Jesus, he knew no sin. He was just that perfect lamb that God wanted. And he dealt not only with the sin problem, he also dealt with the sickness problem. He dealt with it. He dealt with it. We saw in Galatians 3:13, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. Christ has redeemed us. Not going to redeem us. No. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. You see, in order to defeat the problem, he became the problem. He didn't become a sinner. He didn't become a sinner. No. He became sin to deal with the sin problem. Yes. And he became a curse. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse. He was made a curse. Because the curse of the law is threefold. The consequences for breaking God's law is threefold. One is spiritual death. The second is sickness and disease. The third is poverty, lack. So I mean, our sicknesses were laid on Jesus. Isaiah 53, 4 and 5. Surely he hath borne our griefs, literal Hebrew, sicknesses and diseases, and carried our sorrows, literal Hebrew, pains. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes we are healed. About 750 years before Jesus came on the scene, God inspired the prophet Isaiah to prophesy about Jesus' coming. And he was saying, surely he hath borne our griefs. Amen. Surely he hath borne. Notice the certainty. Surely he hath borne our griefs. Surely he hath borne our griefs. The word griefs there in the literal Hebrew is sicknesses and diseases. Surely he hath borne our griefs, literal Hebrew, sicknesses and diseases, and carried our sorrows, literal Hebrew, pains. Amen. Amen. You see, that has been dealt with. That has been dealt with. That has been dealt with. Jesus eventually came to consummate God's plan of redemption. Yes, he eventually came to do that. After Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, Peter, inspired by the Spirit of God, wrote to the church, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. Ye were healed. You see, if we were healed about 2,000 years ago by the stripes of Jesus, and we actually were healed, then right now, we are already healed. We're already healed. We're already healed. We're already healed. Praise the Lord. We're already healed. 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 You see, the greatest miracle that there is the new birth. And then you're born again. To appropriate divine healing, oh, it's a lesser miracle, actually. It's a lesser miracle. It's a miracle, true. You need to appropriate it by your faith if you don't have a manifestation of the Holy Ghost. But the greatest miracle that there was, if you're born again, you appropriated it by your faith. You appropriated that miracle by your faith. Amen. Ephesians 2:8 says, by grace are ye saved through faith. That not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. So, the Bible says you're already healed. So whose report will you believe? Whose report will you believe? Would you believe the testimony of your physical senses over and above the testimony of God's word? Amen. Amen. You know, the Bible says that we walk by faith and not by sight. Yes, the just shall live by faith. We walk by faith, not by sight. Habakkuk 2:4 says, the just shall live by his faith. Amen. So I live by my faith. I live by my faith. And God expects every one of us to live by our faith. You need to do something about that measure of faith you got at the new birth. You need to do something about it. You need to do something about it by feeding it regularly. Yes, by feeding it regularly. By feeding it regularly. Feeding it regularly. You know, to no hurt, going over some of these things we've heard before, F.F. Bosworth, he said, most Christians feed their bodies 3 hot meals a day, but their spirits 1 cold snack a week, and then they wonder why they are so weak in faith. So there's that place of us feeding our bodies. True, we do that regularly. We need to do that. Amen. Could we say this together? God's word is, we need to do that. Amen. Could we say this together? God's word is good. I meditate in God's word. I observe to do what his word teaches. My way shall be prosperous. I shall have good success in life. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Matthew 8:17 says, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. Himself took our infirmities. Bear our sicknesses. You see, what he took, we need not take. What he bore, we need not bear. Amen. The same redemptive work that dealt with the sin problem dealt with the sickness problem. Jesus does not need to come again because a doctor said this particular disease you are faced with is incurable. No, he's already dealt with it. Amen. He's already dealt with it. He's already dealt with it. Hallelujah. You see, just like the woman with the issue of blood, where Jesus said to her in Mark 5:34, daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace and be whole of thy plague. Your faith too can make you whole. 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 Amen. Your faith can make you whole. You know, we don't have to wait for the troubling of the water. We don't have to wait for a manifestation of the Holy Ghost. We don't have to. Yes. John 15:7. Jesus said, if ye abide in me and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. So when we are appropriating divine healing by our faith, it is us initiating divine healing. But when it's by a manifestation of the Holy Ghost, it's God initiating divine healing. Amen. Amen. And it's as the Spirit of God wills, not as we will. Glory to God. Yes. So we've seen healing is always God's will for the sick because it is in his redemptive plan. It is in his redemptive plan. God had a plan of redemption, which he planned and sent his son, the Lord Jesus Christ, to consummate. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You see, faith begins where the will of God is known. Faith begins where the will of God is known. If you don't know the will of God concerning a matter, you can't exercise faith intelligently. You'll be groping in the dark, and that's where the devil thrives. Amen. Yes. So faith begins where the will of God is known. Amen. You know, faith, we cannot act beyond our actual knowledge of God's word. We cannot act beyond our actual knowledge of God's word. Yes. And there's that place where, you know, that place of feeding our faith regularly. Fellowship with God is the mother of faith. It's the parent of joy. It's the source of victory. Faith has no song when fellowship is broken. But when fellowship is at flood tide, faith becomes a masterful force. Faith becomes a masterful force when fellowship is at flood tide. What do we mean when fellowship is at flood tide? You know, just imagine you're prepared for an exam in the natural, and you've, you know, some people say, want to give the examiner marking scheme, that kind of a thing. You're not prepared for an exam. You're at the cutting edge, so to speak. Yes, that's what we mean when we say, when fellowship is at flood tide. You see, every step out of love means broken fellowship. But when you're walking in love, because that's the law that is to govern God's family, you're walking in love, yes, your fellowship with God is at flood tide then. But every step out of love means broken fellowship. And it's dangerous to walk in broken fellowship as a believer in Christ, as a Christian. It's dangerous to do that. Yes, so fellowship with God is the mother of faith. It takes no effort on the part of the intellect or the will of man to get faith. Once the light of God's word gets into the heart of man, faith is there. Faith follows light. It follows the light of God's word. Just feed your faith regularly. You may not even be faced with an incurable disease like some are faced with. You know, like it's been said in Rema, I mean, almost I can't count how many times it's been said, you don't build your house when it is raining. You build your house when it's not raining. So that before it starts raining, you already have a roof over your head. Amen. You don't wait until the doctor gives you a negative report that this one, nothing medical science can do about it. No. No. We are wise in the natural, in most of life. But, you know, would that place of okay, you know, the Bible says a prudent man foreseeth the evil and hideth himself. So it's good we just, ahead of time, we are prepared. We are prepared. We are prepared. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Then some emphasis we could just go on to make concerning healing is always God's will for the sick because it is in his redemptive plan. You see, part of the redemptive package was not just being forgiven. Yes, we're forgiven at the new birth, but beyond forgiveness was that we became new creatures. We became new creatures. You see, under the old covenant, their sins were covered. Their sins were covered. But when we became new creatures, our sins were not covered. No, they were washed away. Amen. We became brand new miracle creations in Christ. Yes. And so We need to be conscious of that, that we are new creatures now. We're not just merely forgiving our sins. Amen. We are new creatures now with the very life of God in us. God's very nature is in our spirits. He imparted his substance and being into our spirits at the new birth. You see, God's life is in me. God's nature is in me. God's ability is in me. God's wisdom is in me. Amen. We've got God's very substance in our spirits. Amen. His very being is in us. Glory to God. They didn't have the greater one on the inside under the old covenant in the Old Testament. They didn't have that. That's part of what makes our covenant better and established upon better promises. Praise the Lord. You know, you have a 10 naira note. And then you have a 1,000 naira note. Which one is better? Praise the Lord. Amen. Really, if you said the 10 naira note is better, maybe you may just need to repeat some basics. 1,000 and lighter notes. I know no intelligent person would say 10 naira is better. Even some people that don't even know, if you give them mathematics to calculate, they don't understand it. But give them money, they understand it. Amen. So we know that 1,000 naira note is far, far, far better. Why? Because in the 1,000 naira notes, you have many, 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 many 10 naira notes. Praise the Lord. Our covenant is far, far, far better than what they had under the old covenant. And they appropriated divine healing. Israel, as long as they walked in the light of the covenant they were under, they were without sickness. The Bible says he brought them out with silver and gold, and there was none feeble amongst their tribes. None feeble. Fools, because of their transgressions, because of their iniquities, afflicted. Their soul abhorreth all manner of meat. They draw nigh unto the gates of death. They cry unto the Lord in their distress. And he saved them. He sent his word and healed them and delivered them from their destructions. You see, when they walked in the light of the covenant they were under, they were protected. I mean, the consequences of spiritual death, the effect of spiritual death was suspended. And it didn't have any effect on them. So they could walk, they could appropriate divine healing, they could stay in health. Abraham, I mean, lived how many years without sickness and disease? Moses, his eyes, you know, why? Because they walked in the light of the covenant. And for us, under the new covenant, we are to walk in love. If we take any step out of love, we better get back as fast as we can. When we take any step out of love, we are over in the enemy's territory. It's just that simple. It's just that simple. The Bible talks about in 1 Corinthians 11, it says, not discerning the Lord's body, for this many are sick, many are weak, and many sleep, many die prematurely. So we just better walk in love. Better walk in love. Better walk in love. You see, I've proposed the math. I walk in love. I'm telling you, I walk in love. I walk in love. Fall for my flesh, but I'll still smile all the same. And there's such a thing as God's grace accompanying us in this. You know, sometimes when we talk about walking in love, some people just think, walking in love again. So, you know, it's just like, as if you are getting the shorter end of the stick. Yes, that's how it is many times. So if you're feeling like that, you're in good company. Praise the Lord. Amen. But you see, stay there. Stay there. You walk in love. Faith walks by love. I didn't give the commandment. Reverend Tokes didn't give the commandment. Brother Higgin didn't give. Leaders in Rema, Nigeria didn't give the commandment. The Lord Jesus, the head of the church, said, a new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another as I have loved you. That ye also love one another. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one to another. And see, we've been furnished with the love to love with. We've been furnished with it. I want to ask a question. If God told you to carry this microphone from this point to another point, let's say to a kilometer from this place, and you didn't have the ability, there's no way you can do it, and God told you to do it, wouldn't he be unjust? He's furnished us with the love to love with. Romans 5 verse 5 says, hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. He's furnished us with the love to love with. We can forgive if people hurt us. And the truth is this. Let's just prepared ahead of time. People, sometimes they will not even intend to do it, but they will just rub off on you in a way that you may not feel like, I mean, feel good about. So you just get ready to forgive people ahead of time. Amen. Amen. Because this one area Jesus warned us about. And when you stand praying, forgive, if you have aught against any. When you stand praying, forgive, 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 forgive. You know, we're in good company, right? Paul, he was beaten with stripes. Him and Silas. The Bible says in Acts 16, Paul and Silas, they prayed. They were in prison. They prayed and sang praises to God. The prisoners heard them. You see, their chains were broken. God's power moved in that prison cell. Why? Because they didn't complain. They didn't gripe. They didn't say, God, punish those people that hurt us. No. Paul walked in love. Paul walked in love. I just like to remember his testimony. I don't like Cain in the natural. I don't like being beaten. In secondary school, I never liked it. Never liked it. I didn't imagine the kind of beating they gave Paul was not that kind of beating, though. The one they do in secondary school is kindergarten compared to the kind they give to Paul. And then they beat him like that. He was in prison. He wouldn't feel good about it. The same gospel we are preaching today, he was preaching the same gospel. And then for the same gospel, he was beaten. Sometimes I just console myself, Joseph, have you been beaten like Paul? Yes, somebody did you something you don't feel good about, but have you gone through the kind of thing Paul went through for the sake of the same gospel? He didn't complain. He didn't hold things against anybody. Do you see that he was such a phenomenon? Yeah, he was such a phenomenon. I mean, he did exploits for the gospel. One person apart from Jesus, we know that he finished his course. The Bible tells us he finished his race. The assignment God will have him do was Paul. Apart from Jesus, we know in God's word in the New Testament, Paul did. But he was strong about love. God inspired him to write 1 Corinthians 13. Amen. Amen. So we just walk in love. We need to do that. We need to do that. Would you feel like doing it? No, the Bible does not say the love of God is shed abroad in our heads. It doesn't need to line up with reasoning. No, we forgive. We let people that have hurt us go. Forgive. We forgive. Love forgives. Amen. Amen. And you see, part of what we have in the new covenant is that the greater one is in us. Romans 8:11. Romans 8:11. Could we turn our Bibles there? You're born again, the greater one is in you. He's in you. He's in you. Glory to God. Amen. He's in you. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's in you. Glory to God. Romans 8:11. Thank you, sir. Go read together, please. But if the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his spirit that dwelleth in you. Again, please. But if the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his spirit that dwelleth in you. Yes. This is part of what we need to know, have spiritual understanding about, when it comes to God's will concerning sickness and disease. Remember, we are looking at healing is always God's will for the sick because it is in his redemptive plan. And we are saying that part of what we have in redemption, this new covenant we are under, is that the greater one is in us. You're born again, the greater one is in you. Even if you're not baptized in the Holy Ghost with the Bible evidence of speaking in other tongues, the greater one is in you. I want to ask a question. Is it greater than headaches? Praise the Lord. You think about it. Is the greater one in you greater than headaches? Is it greater than malaria? I just like to think like that. And it just helps me. You know, is it greater than headaches? Is it greater than malaria? You can have a jolly good laugh. Praise the Lord. Is it greater than cancer? You know, one of the challenges with people who are even really sick, as in, when you even look at their face, they've lost their joy. They've lost their joy. They begin to gripe, complain. That's why they are in the state they are. Amen. Could we say this together? My words work for me. I fill my words with the power that cannot be resisted. I fill my words with faith and love. My words bless. My words heal. My words lead my loved ones. My words lead my loved ones into victory. My words charge the atmosphere of my home with faith and love. You see, our words saturate the very atmosphere that we carry. Yes, beyond the cologne and all of that we use, the perfumes, nothing is more important than the words we speak. You see, there is that speaketh like the piercings of a sword, but the tongue of the wise is health. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. Amen. Like, you know, it's been said in Rema, you see, the Bible didn't say death and life are in the power of the devil. No. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. And they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. Amen. So you see, what defeats us in life is wrong thinking, wrong believing, and wrong speaking. These truths, we just need to go over them again. Yeah, we've gone over them before, but you see, it just does something to us again. When we go, you probably have eaten rice last week. You're likely, you know, not everybody have such meals as their staple food. Some people prefer beans than rice. Okay? Some prepare some other things. But what we're just simply saying is certain things you've eaten before, you still eat them again and eat them again and eat them again in the natural. And we don't complain. So certain truths we've gone over before, go over it again. Truly, God will not be angry that we went through certain truths in the Bible about his redemptive plan, which he planned and sent the Lord Jesus to consume it. He wouldn't be angry. Actually, he'll be happy. Hebrews 2:1 says, therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them sleep. So there's that place of going through certain truths again and again. Why? Because we don't outgrow the basic building blocks of God's word. We don't outgrow them. We don't outgrow them. No matter the kind of grammar people speak today, it still boils back to the about 27 alphabets in English language. No matter they put the words together, phenomenon, you know, several words we speak. Some of them, when some people who are still attending the kindergarten, you even hear some words, they're like, ah, you can spell that. Even me that I'm this age to hear such words, you know, xylophone, xenophobia, some words like that. I've even heard some words that about probably 20 alphabets put together, I've heard one. Yes. I'm like, what is this? It was somebody's name spelled like that. Yes. But the basic building blocks were still A, B, C, D, E, down to the last, X, Y, Z. The same thing with God's word. There are certain basic building blocks we should stay with. We'll never outgrow them. We'll never outgrow them. Amen. So we need to be conscious that a greater one is in us. We need to get to that place where we know, not in our heads, we know from our hearts, the reality of the greater one in us. He's greater than sickness and disease. He's greater. He's greater. He's greater. He's greater. He's greater than sickness and disease. He's greater than adverse circumstances. You see, all the forces put in this world together, not just in this world, in the world to come, put together, arrayed against us, cannot stand the greater one in us. I like to think like that. Cannot stand. Oh, glory to God. You know, there's this song that just comes to my heart. Who can stand against the Lord? No one can. If you're wise, you will not even dare. Amen. The devil even has, I mean, is that smart? The Bible says, submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will do what? He'll flee from you. You know, he'll flee from you. When Jesus resisted the devil by quoting the word, the devil had enough sense to take off. Praise the Lord. Because that's the sword of the spirit that we have, the word of God. The word of God. The word of God. The word of God. God's word is good. God's word is good. It's just something he does to us. Just something he does to us. just something he does to us. You see, I also like to look at faith from another perspective. Thank God for the results it helps us to get. But you see, if you're just thinking about result, there's a way it will do you, that you are faced with a challenge, maybe a medical challenge, and then